So this talk is about building secure Macs. So in this work, we propose a new Wegman-Carter-style Mac, which is called, so the ugly acronym is for Encrypted Wegman-Carter with Davis-Meyer. And this new Mac is based on a XOR universal hash function and a block cipher, and it has the following properties. So first, it is quite efficient. It requires only two block cipher calls, one of which can be computed in parallel to the hash function. And it is secure beyond the burst debound when nonces are not repeated, and it retains security up to the burst debound when nonces are reused. So as you can see, there are some similarities with what we've done in the previous mode that I presented in the previous talk. And actually, it's kind of a follow-up on the SCT mode. So again, the rationale behind that is that we want this new Mac to be very secure when nonces do not repeat, which should be the nominal usage. And we want security not to be completely destroyed when nonces are inadvertently repeated. Okay. So the outline of the talk will be as follows. So first, I will give some background on Wegman-Carter Macs. Then I will describe the new construction, and I will give very quick sketch of the proof. So first, so what are Macs message authentication codes? So as usual, we have Alice and Bob who wants to communicate over an insecure channel, which is potentially controlled by the attacker here. And they want to send messages, and they want to detect when the attacker modifies the messages which are transmitted. So what do? They share a secret key, K, and they compute so some function of the message. And so in this talk, we consider nonce-based Mac, which means that they also include in the computation a value which should not repeat a nonce. And they compute a tag T, which is transmitted with the message. Okay? And so we don't want the adversary to be able to forge tags, which means to compute tags for new messages that it hasn't seen before. So how do we define formally security for this primitive? So we have an adversary which has two oracles, a MAC oracle and a verification oracle. And it can make QM MAC queries to the MAC oracle, and it can make QV verification queries. You can see this as forgery attempts to the verification oracle. And the adversary is successful if one of the verification queries passes. And of course, if this query has not been obtained from the MAC oracle, which would be a trivial win. And we say that the adversary is, so as in the previous talk, that it is nonce-respecting if it does not repeat nonces in the MAC oracle. Okay? So for verification queries, it can do whatever it wants, but we disallow him to repeat nonces in macros. So one of the oldest way to build such a primitive is what is called Wegman-Carter Max, which has been proposed by Wegman and Carter, building on previous work by Gilbert, McWilliams, and Sloan. So how does it work? So you use what is called an almost XOR universal hash function. So what is it? This is a hash function which a keyed, so hash function, such that for any two inputs, M and M prime, and any value Y, the probability when you draw a random key that the XOR of the two outputs is equal to Y is less than some small value epsilon. So in other words, it has small differential probabilities. So you use such a universal hash function, you hash your message, and you simply encrypt it or mask it with a one-time pad. Okay? So for each message, you have to use a one-time pad. So the key for this Mac is the hashing key, and as many one-time pads as you need to authenticate your messages. So it's not very practical to share a large number of one-time pads. So what we do in practice is that we replace the one-time pad by a pseudo-random function computed on a nonce. Okay? So the role of the nonce here is to act as a pseudo-random pad. So what is interesting with this construction is that first, if you really use it with one-time pads, security is information theoretic. So once you replace one-time pads with a pseudo-random function, security is as good as the security of your pseudo-random function, but it's still very good if you use a good pseudo-random function. What is interesting also is that this primitive here can be implemented very efficiently. For example, if you can use polynomial evaluation, as in GCM or as in poly 1305. And it has, so as I said, it has information theoretic security, so kind of optimal security. And in particular, the bound is given by epsilon times the number of forgery attempts for verification queries, plus a term which reflects the security of the pseudo-random function. Okay? So with as many queries as the sum of MAC queries and verification queries. Okay. So this is the standard bound for Wegman-Carter MACs. So in principle, it's very good. But in practice, there are two problems. The first problem is that usually you will implement your pseudo-random function with a block cipher. In many situations, you don't want to implement a MAC or a hash function or something. You just have a block cipher, so the basic idea would be to replace the function here with a block cipher. And the problem is that the nice provable security bound that we had drops to something which is much weaker, namely the birthday bound, because of the PRF-PRP switching lemma. Okay, so here, the PRF advantage of a block cipher, because of this PRF-PRP switching lemma, will be the number of queries squared over 2 to the n. Okay, and this term here will usually dominate this one. Okay, so you lose a lot from a provable security point of view when you do this. There is a better bound than this one by Bernstein, but it's still of birthday type. So let me mention right now that there is a solution, which is to use a beyond birthday bound secure PRP to PRF conversion, and I will come back on this later. So this is the first problem. How do you implement your PRF if you only have a block cipher? The second problem is the non-Smith use problem. So Wegman-Carter MACs are actually very brittle, in the sense that a single nonce repetition can completely break security, especially for polynomial-based hashing, which means that the hash function here is a polynomial which depends on the message evaluated on the secret key. If you repeat, it's quite easy to see that if you repeat a nonce a single time in, when computing a MAC, the adversary will be able to compute a polynomial with key, and the key will be a root of this polynomial. So this gives a lot of information to the adversary. And in fact, it has been a recurrent criticism against GCM, this nonce misuse problem. And the solution to this problem is also known, which is just to add an extra PRF call to the output here. And in fact, in this case, it's okay to use, you don't lose security if you encrypt rather than using a PRF. And if you do this, then this non-Smith use problem disappears because, in particular, this kind of attack doesn't apply anymore. Okay, so I will now explain this new construction that we propose. So the goal here, as I explained at the beginning, is to design an efficient Wegman-Carter-like MAC, which is based only on a block cipher. So, which is secure beyond the birthday bound in the nonce when nonces are not repeated, and which retains nonce misuse resistant at least up to the birthday bound. And so, if you want to do this with so the state of our solution to design a MAC with all these properties, is to use this construction here that I just explained, so which we call encrypted Wegman-Carter, because we have a Wegman-Carter here and an extra call to a block cipher to encrypt this value here to avoid non-Smith use problem. So you can start from this and simply use what is called a PRP to PRF conversion method to implement your pseudo-random function. So what is PRP to PRF conversion, also called in a seminal paper, Lubyarkov backwards, is simply the question, how do you construct from a block cipher something which is indistinguishable from a random function, with ideally up to two to the n queries. Okay, so you can use the block cipher itself, but it's only a secure PRF up to two the n over two queries. Okay, so you can use truncation. You can take a block cipher and truncate the output. This works, but you have to start from a very large block cipher to have good bounds. So the standard way to do this is what is called the XOR construction, which has been investigated by Lux and Patarin. And you simply compute the encrypt your input with two different keys, and you XOR the output. Okay? Or you can also truncate your output and append a 0 and 1 and encrypt with the same key and XOR the output. This is called the twin construction, and it has also been investigated by Lux. And these two constructions here have very good security. Okay, it's a DDB secure PRF, and it's secure up to 2 to the n queries, close to 2 to the n queries. So kind of optimal security for a PRP to PRF conversion meta. So if you do this, you start from this encrypted Wegmann-Carter construction, and you instantiate your pseudorandom function here using a PRP to PRF construction, and your problem is solved. Okay, you have a Wegmann-Carter MAC, which is beyond the secure when nonces do not repeat, and which is non-species resistant thanks to the outer encryption layer. Okay, but only up to the birthday bound. But this requires at least three block cipher calls. And the question is it possible to do better? So actually, this kind of design is exactly what we used in the SCT mod that I talked about before. And at this time, we didn't know how to make it more efficient. So we used exactly this sum of two PRPs construction to achieve beyond birthday bound security. So the question is, can we do better than three block cipher calls? And the answer is yes. And this is what we call now the encrypted Wegmann-Carter construction with Davis-Meyer. And the simple idea is just to instantiate here this pseudo-random function with what we call the Davis-Meyer construction, which is the easiest way to turn a permutation into a function, which is depicted here. So you just encrypt your nonce and you XOR the nonce to the output. Okay, so this destroys the bijectivity. Okay, it's not a permutation anymore, it's a function. But the problem is that this is not a beyond birthday secure PRF. It's quite easy to see that this construction, this Davis-Meyer construction here, there is a distinguishing attack with birthday complexity. If I give you an oracle and I ask you to distinguish between a purely random function and a Davis-Meyer mode, you just ask queries to your oracle and you XOR the input and you look for collisions in these values. And if there is collisions, then it was a truly random function. And if you don't find collision, you guess it's a Davis-Meyer construction. Okay? So this is not beyond birthday secure. Okay? So how could this give beyond birthday security when nonces do not repeat? But in fact, here, this attack here is not, you cannot apply it because of the outer encryption layer here. Okay, if you try, you really to do this attack, this distinguishing attack on Davis-Meyer, you really need to have access to the outputs of the Davis-Meyer construction. And here you don't have access because of the outer encryption layer. So maybe there is hope that this construction here gives beyond birthday security when nonces do not repeat. And this is actually what we prove. So let me first give you the security result that we prove in the paper. So here n is the block length of the block cipher, and it's also the tag length. Lmax is the maximal message length in n bit blocks. And what we prove is security up to what the important term here that we improve over the basic Wegmann-Carter is QM to the 3 over 2 over 2 to the n. So this means that this is secure up to 2 to the 2n over 3. So you have also this term here, which gives you this term here. and up to epsilon minus one for the number of verification queries. So epsilon here is the parameter of your universal hash function. So this gives us beyond birthday security when nonces do not repeat, and when nonces can be repeated, then we get back to birthday bound, classical birthday bound for Wegmann-Cartamax. So now let me sketch quickly how we prove this result. So first, you can observe that we cannot start by replacing the Davis-Meyer construction here by a random function, right? Because if we do this, the reduction will have a birthday bound which appears directly. So really, what we need to do is to consider the PRF security of this part here. So forget for now about the hash of the message and consider just what happens to the nonce. So it is first encrypted with, well, not encrypted, but you first apply the Davis-Meyer construction and then you encrypt it. And what we need to do in the proof is to analyze the PRF security of this construction. So actually, we call this construction here the encrypted Davis-Meyer construction, because we have Davis-Meyer and we encrypt it. And what we prove actually in the paper, a large part of the proof is to prove that this is a PRP to PRF construction. So to the best of my knowledge, it has never been considered before, but I think it's interesting to have. And so a large part is to prove that this is secure. So we prove that this is secure up to 2 to the 2n over 3 queries. And for this, we use the hash coefficients technique that was mentioned in the first talk in this session. So I will not enter into the details, but so this technique considers the transcript of the attack. Okay, so we have an adversary which makes queries to an oracle, and we consider the transcript of this attack. And we have to separate the transcript between good and bad transcript. So in our proof, a bad transcript will be a transcript which has too many collisions in the output. Okay. And actually, it's quite easy that collisions are slightly more likely for the Davis-Meyer construction than for a random function. So in a second part of the proof, we need to show that actually it's not too less likely than for a random function. Okay. So what we need to do is simply a counter argument for lower bounding the number of pair of permutations p prime p second that yield a given good transcript. So I don't have time to enter into the details, but it's just quite a simple counting argument. And doing this, we prove security up to 2 to the 2n over 3 queries. So actually, I'm not sure about what is the exact security of this construction. If you try to find an attack, I can't see any attack which uses less than 2 to the n queries. In fact, if you look at all you could, the statistics of the outputs of Davis-Meyer seems quite close to the statistics of a random function. And once you encrypt it, you just simply cannot make the standard attack on Davis-Meyer, and basically you cannot do much more. So maybe it's secure up to 2 to the n queries, but we don't have a proof yet. Another problem now, so now this was just for the nonce part of the construction, but we do have now to handle also the message part. And the problem is that the message and the encrypted Davis-Meyer construction are kind of intermingled, which means that we cannot use the PRF security of this part and use it in a black box way to prove the security of the entire MAC. And actually, this is what makes the security proof a bit painful. Actually, the PRF security is quite easy to prove, but once you need to take into account this message here, it becomes a bit of a mess. And the full proof needs to handle, in particular, the verifications queries directly. Usually for Wegmann-Cartamax, you can first prove that the tags are random, and then build on this to prove that verification queries will always fail. Here, you cannot exactly do this because of this XOR in the middle of the construction. And in fact, to do this, we recast the forgery. The easiest way is to recast the forgery experiment as a distinguishing experiment between the real oracles and a pair of oracles where the first one is always completely random and the second one is always reject. So actually, we prove a bit more, but it seems to be easier, at least using the hash coefficients technique. So again, we use the hash coefficients technique to prove the full result. So time to conclude. So we propose this new construction, which is the interesting feature of this construction is that the outer encryption layer here turns out to be twice useful, right? First, this encryption layer here, which provides burst debound non-species resistance, and this is also this encryption layer here, which provides non-respecting beyond burst debound security, okay? When combined with this cheap feed-forward of the nonce. So maybe there is a lesson to learn here, which is usually when you have a construction which is non-species resistant, maybe you don't have to work too much to make it beyond birthday secure when nonces do not repeat. Not sure it's a general rule, but at least we have seen two examples this morning here. And a final observation is that if you have an existing Wegmann-Carter-Mack implementation, okay, which is just this part, without the feed-forward, this new construction is easy to implement in a black box way from your implementation. You just have to XOR your nonce and re-encrypt it, and that's it. And some to finish, some open problems. So as I said, we only prove security up to 2 to the 2n over 3 Mack queries, but we don't have any matching attacks, so maybe the security is even better than that. Another interesting problem is what happens if you use the same key for the two black cipher calls here. So for now, we have analyzed only the security of the PRF, which turns out to be also 2 to the 2n over 3. But we have problems with the message part for now. So we're not sure it's the Mack is secure when you use the same keys here. And finally, something which in practice is often used is what happens if you truncate your tag here. What is the effect on security? We haven't investigated this for now. That's it. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much.